If we can bring the meeting to order, can I welcome you to this, the 7th meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in this session. Can I remind members and others in the room to switch phones and other devices to silent. We have today received apologies from Maurice Corey. Edward Mountain is attending in Maurice's place as the committee substitute and I'd like to welcome you to our meeting. Can I ask you to declare any relevant interests?
In the register of interest, I am a farmer and I have an interest in a fishery on the River Spey. Those are my only interests.
Okay, thank you very much. Can we now move then to agenda item number one, the consideration of new petitions. Petition 1623 on unelected church appointees on local authority education committees. Our first item on the agenda today is petition PE 1623, lodged by Spencer Fields on behalf of the Scottish Secular Society. It calls for a change to current practice provided under section 124 of the Local Government Scotland Act 1973, which requires that local authorities' education committees must include members nominated by various churches. The petition collected over 700 signatures and received 48 comments, mostly in support of its aims. Can I welcome Mr. Fields to the meeting? And he is accompanied by Professor Paul Braterman of the Scottish Secular Society. Can I thank you for attending today? And can I now provide you with the opportunity for a short opening statement, after which we'll move to questions from the committee?
Yes, first of all, can I thank you for inviting us, convener, and my thanks to the rest of the committee as well. At present, every council education committee in Scotland is required by law to include 3 full voting members nominated by churches. Voters and their elected representatives have no choice in this matter. This legal requirement dates back to 1929 and in its present form to 1973. It's so broadly worded that it could actually apply to any future education system. We believe this current system is out of place and does not reflect a constantly evolving, rapidly modernising Scottish democracy. We would not dream of allowing churches to impose its members on this Parliament's Education and Skills Committee, for instance, but that is exactly what we do with Scottish councils. The future of Scottish education is currently under active discussion, and we believe this would be the perfect time to review the status quo. One major consideration is the fact that parents who hold no belief now represent the majority amongst primary school parents. This has created a democratic deficit across representation within local authorities. To address this change in demographic, we respectfully suggest that the simplest change would be to relax the requirement. We would like to see the law allowing, not compelling, local authorities, elected members to appoint up to 3 representatives and to decide whether or not they should give them voting powers, much as they do right now for parent-teacher councils and representatives. We actually gauged the view of all of Scotland's MSPs by writing directly to them. We found we did have some considerable cross-party support in our responses. If I could just quote, make some comments here as to some of the responses we received. We had comments such as there may well be merit in looking at this afresh again. There should be a greater amount of autonomy in choosing the best people, whether or not they be religious. I am broadly supportive of the concept of members of the education committees being elected members. And it is up to each local authority to decide who should be on education committees. And finally, the last one was the status quo is currently an anachronism. Professors of the petition include supporters include Professor Damon Glover, who was scientific advisor to the Scottish Government and the European Union, the Clergy Letter Project, who are actually an organisation of 15,000 ordained clergy, a global representative body, the Secretary of the Glasgow Unitarian Church and the Glasgow Theosophical Society. Our petition statement shows the present situation is undemocratic, unjust, and actually encroaches on human rights and is highly problematic in its actual enforcement. It infringes on local autonomy and is actually the opposite of participatory democracy. It's unnecessary since denominational schools have their own separate mechanisms of governance. Many churches are already involved to some extent with most schools across Scotland, including non-denominational schools. Believers, like everyone else, can and should vote and take part in public debate and stand for office. However, unlike what we are challenging today, religion in this case should be afforded no privilege to those and against those who hold no belief. It infringes on local autonomy because laws handed down by central government in the case of 1973 and 1994 Westminster governments are imposed on local councils irrespective of the council's wishes and needs. It's certainly not participatory democracy. The broader community is not involved, and the appointees are answerable only to their own churches. Finally, many councils have difficulty filling the actual positions. There are some, in our view, that have some questionable appointments. If the system was meeting a legitimate need, this problem would surely never arise in the first place. The Church of Scotland itself admits in its own response to the petition that there is an element of reform that is required, and the simplest one, we believe, is the one that we suggested. Scotland's regions are highly diverse. We believe local councils themselves are the best people to judge what the local needs are. And they have a local mandate already in place for them from the voting system, and they should be free to use that. In conclusion, we would respectfully ask you seek opinions from organisations that represent non-believing as well as believing bodies, and from organisations concerned with schooling, so concerned with human rights, such as Time for Inclusive Education and the Equality and Human Rights Commission, with a view to forwarding our petition to the Education and Skills Committee. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much for your statement. I have a couple of questions before I open it up to my colleagues. You did mention this. I mean, first of all, you'll be aware that in response to a previous petition on this issue in February 2014, the Scottish Government indicated its support for, quote, the involvement of religious representatives in the decision-making process by councils in relation to education, and did not at that time, quote, have any plans to change the existing provisions. But as you mentioned, they're currently undertaking a governance review of Scottish education. Do you see that as a means by which you might make your views known and can highlight this whole question of education committees? And secondly, did you seek the views of individual local authorities on what they thought of the mechanism that currently applied to them in terms of education
committees? Yeah, to answer your first question, yes, we are actually participating in consultations. So we've been invited along through the Equalities Network and other bodies. We've had representation. They're ongoing process, as you know, at the moment. So we have chucked our oar in, for want of a better term. Regarding the local education authorities themselves, we didn't receive any responses from many of them because they believe that this matter should be referred back to the government because it's a matter of legislation. So, like most things that are politically sensitive or administratively sensitive, we didn't really expect them to have a statement on the issue itself. So that's where we sat.
Although it would be the case that local authorities, if they feel strongly about particular bits of legislation's impacts and then would make their views known, then there would be evidence of this. I just wonder if you're aware at a local authority level, if there are individual local authorities who are saying we're not happy with this or they have concerns. Yeah. I mean, you talked about maybe difficulty in filling places.
Yeah, what we did a freedom of information request on how these places are actually filled. And out of them, what we found on 9 of them, that they really struggled to fill the places and they had to go out to newspaper advertisements. And they were basically left with some churches being the only ones that would actually stand up and do the job because they were the only ones around or the only ones that were actually willing to do it. So they had so for them, that must be, if you're any large budgetary holder or policy maker, decision maker, that must be really frustrating. So the only feedback that we really got in that sense was the way that they actually go about the recruitment process, not the how they felt about the people who were actually on or formed part of the committee itself. So one of the key things that really raised its head was how problematic that system actually is and how they find it difficult to get the right people to come in and participate.
It doesn't suggest, however, there's a drive by people who are who are religious to get themselves onto committees and to because there's some suggestion, obviously, that they have a disproportionate influence or an inappropriate influence. You're saying if they're having difficulties recruiting, it would suggest there's not that kind of drive by the churches and others.
Which is the base of our argument, then. If the need is not being filled, if that current piece of legislation is not being mandated, then surely that is a suggestion that the process is beginning to fall apart, that it's not working. And maybe that is also because of the changing landscape of religion in the Scottish, in our country, is the fact that, you know, maybe 100 years ago, when these things really mattered, when 99.9% of the population were of some religion, Now we're finding that it's more than half actually make up no religion. So maybe that is a reflection of the change in dynamic, is the fact that this is becoming more difficult for local authorities to meet that need.
Okay, Angus McDonald.
Could I add perhaps that there's very distinguished precedent for people prominent within the churches to stand for election.
Just a second, sorry, Paul.
Can we take the next question and I'll bring you in then?
Thanks, convener. Good morning, gentlemen. In the background information to your petition, you refer to the recruitment process, and you say that in 17 out of 32 cases, there's reason for concern about the way in which the system is operating. Without referring to any specific cases, can I ask you to expand on that statement?
Paul?
That's right.
Sorry, could you... Yeah. Speak up just a little bit more.
Okay, I'm sorry, I've got a bit of a cold today. So. I'll repeat the question. In the background information to your petition, you refer to the recruitment process, and in your statement you say that in 17 out of 32 cases there is reason for concern about the way in which the system is operating. So without going into any specific details or cases, can I ask you both to expand on these concerns?
Yeah, certainly. In 15 cases out of 32 local authorities, the position is actually filled by a newspaper advertisement. In 8 of those cases, there was only one response to the advertisement. As for problematic appointments, there are, to our knowledge, at least 6 cases where one of the appointees, usually the third appointee, is a committed creationist, young earth creationist, and therefore committed to denying key elements of the curriculum for excellence being taught in the schools that they're supposed to administer. In one case, Falkirk in fact, there's the third nominee is there because the church first requested to nominate, never got around to responding, and is a member of a church affiliated to the Assemblies of God, which asks people to vote for Donald Trump. And all in all, we just, in one case, the third nominee nominated himself just after having lost his seat in an election on the strength of his involvement with the Boys Brigade. So I think this illustrates the kind of problems that we have.
Okay, thanks. Having served on the Falkirk Council Education Committee, I've been following clearly the developments on that committee. However, as I recall, is it not the case in some local authorities, including Falkirk for a while, church appointees do not have any voting rights on education committees? And, you know, would that be acceptable if that were to be the case in all local authorities to you?
I think our argument really isn't the presence of members of the church being on the education committees. It's the mechanism in which they actually appear on the committees. And that's what we're seeking to broaden. If someone from the Catholic Church or the Church of Scotland or a Unitarian is the best person for the job, the most qualified, and is there by the will of the local authority, then that is the case. That is an open, democratic, participatory nature of approaching the issue. But to go back and say, you can have this position because you are religious, and that is the only qualification that exists in this case, we think needs to be amended. What they do when they're there, if it's the will of the local authority then and the people in that locality, then that is the will of that locality. But as it stands, there's a huge imbalance. And demographically, there's a huge imbalance, especially when you look at how the different religions are now spread around Scotland. If you take Glasgow, for instance, there's a large concentration of people within the Muslim community, but they're not equally represented on these education boards. Whereas if you go to the Highlands, it's very different. And these are things that no one's actually looking at the moment. They're not being addressed. So we think the best way forward to address this is to make them all equal from the outset and appoint them purely based on qualification.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, convener. Your petition refers to a 2011 consensus, which indicates that 56% of the population have a religious affiliation. In your information from your petition, it also says that the census figures show a steady decline in religious affiliation among Scots, and I wonder if you could provide us with more information on that trend and how you might be able to demonstrate that.
Yeah, of course. We actually used your own evidence. We used the Scottish Household Surveys and the Scottish there's Social Attitude Surveys as well, which are now consistently showing that those who claim to have no belief are over 50% every year, and that is on a trajectory as well. And if you look within the demographic and you look at those parents who are now sending their children to primary school, that goes up to 64%. And again, I believe that this is on the Scottish Social Attitude Survey of 2014. So, yeah, the data certainly suggests that with the census. The census is great offering a substrate, but it doesn't move with the times. And right now, the times are moving very fast. And those who openly claim to have no religious affiliation are now the majority in Scotland.
Thank you. I mean, your petition sets out your views on the current system. And I just wonder what work you've done to understand whether your views and concerns are shared by pupils and parents and others with an interest in the delivery of the education system.
Yeah, this petition is part of it. The Secular Society itself, we run our own membership system. We also run which I think everyone does nowadays, a Facebook group, which is the quickest and fastest way of connecting to everybody. So we constantly canvass our members on our Facebook group. We also have discussions every first Thursday in the Theosophical Society in Glasgow. And recently we invite educationists along, we invite people from different faiths, from those of no faith, and we always ask these questions. So although we have no precise methodical approach or scientific approach to looking at this, we do have a census of opinion that comes back anecdotally, and certainly through the Secular Society themselves, through the complaints system that we have from parents regarding all sorts of issues with religion in schools. This is a factor that consistently comes up. Now, for us, this to make any difference or to have any influence at what happens at school and ground level, we have to go further up the tree, to the top of the tree, the hierarchy there. And part of that is the local education authorities and the influence that we believe that some religious representatives may have, especially those where they may hold the balance of power in some local education authorities. And, you know, I would find it difficult to believe that anyone who is religious or is responsible to their church can decouple their religion in these conversations. I think it should drive part of what they are and who they are. But it comes back to our original point, is there's many people out there who don't hold a belief, feel that they're not being fairly represented. And even looking at this on paper, it's difficult to argue that by our figures, the largest majority do not hold a belief system, then why on every single one of the 29 local health authorities is there a Catholic, is there a Protestant, is there another? But that's one privilege for them, but not for the no-belief group. I mean, we just wouldn't do this with literature, we wouldn't do this with science, we wouldn't impose a scientist or a teacher onto any other group, but we do it with religion. And we think now is a good time to start change, start looking at that and examining it.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
In its submission, the Church of Scotland's Church and Society Council comments on parent, pupil and teacher representatives and education committees also being unelected. I appreciate you may well have answered this already, but just to clarify, what's your position on there being unelected representatives other than church representatives on education committees?
It comes back to my point earlier. If that is a need that needs to be met, if the local authority believe that as a requirement, then I think it would be a smarter move to have a broader net. So by doing so, you would have someone who has a more specialist professional interest in it. For instance, my colleague here, Paul, is a professor in chemistry, an emeritus from Glasgow University to the University of Texas, and has spent his entire life considering the best needs of the education of the child. Now, as he pointed out earlier on, you have someone whose qualification is the fact that they worked with the Boys Brigade, or you have an individual like Professor Breiterman here. And not to say that, you know, but if you have two people that you want to competitively interview, who's going to have the biggest impact and add more value to the system, these are the kind of requirements that we really should be taking into consideration. And that is open to, we would like that to be relaxed so local education authorities can then reach out to those type of people.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Can I just move on? Another submission, Andrew Strachan makes the point that if these appointments were removed, there might be an impact on schools who provide faith-based education for local authorities. Our briefing information notes that the current provision reflects the historical roots of school education as a religious concern. What consideration have you given to the impact that a change to the provisions of the ones that you're suggesting might have on schools with a particular religious ethos?
Yeah, we're primarily talking about non-denominational schools. So faith schools is probably a different argument for a different day. We don't believe, and again, this would then validate our point of view. If that local authority decided that the rules were changed, legislation was relaxed, and they didn't make a change, then that's fine. Then that, because that's what they're telling us their needs is to meet the needs of
the
that.
Option.
Yeah,
it's giving them the option
to do so. We currently don't do that. We restrict it. We narrow the aperture, and we just think that it should be widened.
Okay, thank you. Slightly different point though from the one that Professor Braterman was making, which there are some people whose views are such they ought not to be on an education committee.
I see Professor Braterman's view, and I support it, in the sense that even those who are of a particular religious denomination and hold a belief in a worldview, there are some conflicting issues within some. You'll get this with any system. You're not going to get 100% of everything running smoothly 100% of the time. So we have identified under our Freedom of Information request that there are young earth creationists that sit on some of these committees, and it is a worry because they are very proactive in their beliefs.
So your view isn't, your view is that actually it shouldn't really be a matter for local authorities. You said that the consensus now is it's not a matter for local authorities, it's imposed on them. But actually, your view is that people with those kinds of views ought not to serve in education.
No, not really. That's kind of moving the argument slightly there, because our argument is by default, those views would be taken into consideration before that individual was elected onto the committee.
So if the local authority then accepted somebody with those views,
then that's what they accept.
Who thought that Donald Trump should be president, they could be.
Exactly. Well, we see that happens,
but do you also think, though, there is an issue around if there was only 20% of the population had religious views? And it went down to 10%. Should that not mean that we have a responsibility to protect those views or to respect them?
And we do. We do that in the public sphere. We do that legislatively. We do that in every other area. But our biggest responsibility is to uphold the principles of democracy, Joanne. And I think that has to be more critical than anything else. And within that system of democracy, they will naturally be protected as a group anyway. Right now, we have checks and balances in place. We have laws that make sure that we don't discriminate against such groups. But at the moment, the balance is actually is unweighted in the favour of those who are religious against those who are not religious. And we need to draw some middle line here. We need to get to a point where it is actually a win-win for everybody. We are cautious as secularism is a two-way street, and we part of our ethos is that it's freedom of religion and freedom from religion. And we want to make sure that those freedoms for both parties are always upheld. But unfortunately, this is just happens to be one where we think that the balance is skewed in the favour of the other.
So the issue is not really about the balance of views in our society as a whole?
They should have a view.
Your figures around census, and I mean, it's just really to test the arguments here.
Of course, yeah.
Your figures around the number of people who have religious views are not a core issue.
Why would it
be the core issue if we're agreeing that we should protect?
No, all religious views. There should always be a platform, and there should always be a society that permits the manifestation of the expression of a religious perspective. Now, that is freedom of speech. That is what you want to see, and if you believe in that, and you're projecting that somewhere, like on this committee, it is up to that committee whether or not that holds any weight. So, if you are religious and you sit on an education committee, and that forms part of who you are, and you want to project what you are attempting to influence or change or help with, then that's normal discourse. That's fine. But the argument, that's not the argument. The argument is how you get on that seat in the first place, not how religion is perceived or treated in society. That's not an argument. If you're religious and you want to put your name on the ballot box for anything, you can do that anywhere in our society. You can do it with local education committees. But it's what, and if you come out with something that your colleagues on that education committee think is maybe a little bit off the wall or a little bit absurd, then that's between, if they've voted you on, then that's really nothing more to do with us. That's between them and the committee, because the process of getting them onto the committee is the issue that we have. Not what they say when they're there, it's what happens. But we have identified, unfortunately, through the Freedom of Information, that some of the beliefs that are held are contradicted to the curriculum for excellence. So I would see that as being a little bit of an issue, especially in the teaching of biology. If you're a young Earth creationist and you believe Earth is 6,000 years old and you don't believe that we came down from the trees onto the savannah, then you may run into some issue. But that, like I say, is maybe one or two out of every 100. So.
And there would be a question extent to which any individual education committee could determine the curriculum in individual schools anyway. But I mean, that's maybe something that we want to explore. Do anybody else have any other questions?
I probably do. I think we'd have an issue with what you just said there, is that if they do happen to have a view that goes against the curriculum for excellence, surely by your own definition that shouldn't preclude them from standing for office.
No, it doesn't. Because that would then be the decision of the local education authority to decide whether or not that person's views were acceptable and that they were qualified to sit on that committee. But if it's views that contradict the implementation of the curriculum for excellence, which has already been set out, then that's another matter that they have to consider. What this is all this is about is widening the opportunity for local education authorities to enhance the value and quality of what they offer and what they do and what they are. And right now we believe that they are constrained purely because of what we see as an anomaly, historical anomaly, that actually, you know, I appreciate you look for evidence, you look for the checks and balances, the data, the methodology. There's actually none of that takes place for the qualification of religious representatives on. You know, there is no constant mandating whether or not they are effective, whether or not they do have an impact. Nobody measures it. Nobody quantifies it. It's not qualitative. It just happens to be there because it's something we've always done and we continue to do it. That seems to be the reaction. And that was actually the reaction that I received from many of your colleagues as well when I wrote out to them on behalf of the Secular Society.
Can I add very quickly that elected councillors are responsible to the electorate. The representatives of churches are beholden only to the church that nominated them. And in the case of two of the representatives, that's Catholic Church, Church of Scotland. In the case of the third representative, it's very often just the only church that showed up. This is a very curious situation, a lack of accountability. Power without responsibility.
So you wouldn't have lay members on education committees? The logic of that position is you wouldn't have lay members on an education committee, and so the idea that perhaps you might bring in a very significant academic experience, but it's a very strong argument for groups perhaps to support young people with special needs, parents, whoever, who have direct experience of the importance of education are sometimes in these committees. But the logic of that position is that you wouldn't have lay members in the committee.
The logic is that you wouldn't have lay members on the committee by what you've just said. But I would somewhat disagree with that, because again, that's two steps forward, I think, because we're past the process of those who are allowed to make the decision. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but that comes next in our opinion, and that really has not much to do with us. What we're saying is it doesn't matter what the Education Committee decide to do next. It's, for us, what matters is that they can look beyond religious representatives to have whoever they feel fit to do so or most qualified to sit on those committees. So that's really the basis of our argument.
Okay. Well, Lynn, thank you very much for that. I think we've had a reasonable consideration of the issues, and you've had the opportunity to flag up the key issues for you. We obviously want to consider what action we might now take, because clearly there are questions, and it would, I suppose, be useful to know whether the Scottish Government still takes the same view. Maybe we want you to contact them.
First port of call, mm-hmm. to see whether there's a change in attitude, a change of approach from the Government.
And whether it would be worthwhile knowing, actually, do local authorities find this a problem? Would they see the suggestion that local authorities might decide it for themselves? Or are there other groups that we could may ask to take a view?
Would we then therefore write out to every local authority? ask their opinion.
I suppose we could contact COSLA, if that's the easiest way to do it. Because they would know if there was, through their education community, whether there was a kind of a strength of feeling around this or differences in different areas. And perhaps, again, just to test whether this is something that is beyond particular interest of your organisation and write out to a range of organisations to ask them their views.
Yes,
I mean, I'm very supportive of your petition, and I think we need to seek the widest range of views to bring this forward.
Mm-hmm. We have a suggestion in our own briefing, in paragraph 8 of the organisations we might want to write out to. I wonder if people agree with those groups. I don't know whether they want me to read them out.
I think that would be fair to contact all of them.
Okay. So, because we did receive written submissions, is this in the past? These ones, right? Okay. So, you may want to contact, as we've said, Scottish Government COSLA, Scottish Parent Teacher Council, Association of Directors of Education Scotland, the Church of Scotland Education Committee, the Scottish Catholic Education Service, EIS, Interfaith Scotland, the Muslim Council of Scotland, the Equality and Human Rights Commission Scotland, and the Humanist Society of Scotland. Okay.
And just to clarify, are we going to ask the Scottish Government its position, because they're not really covering it in their specifically in their review?
So yeah, well, I think, well, there are two things we might ask them. Mm-hmm. First of all, have they changed their position? But secondly, mm-hmm. what are they doing in order to address this question through the governance review? Because I think it's one mm-hmm. thing for you to be speaking to the Equality Network, but whether you've been invited to give evidence or a view to the Scottish Government is something quite different. Okay, are those actions agreed then? Is there anything else?
Agreed.
No, agreed. In that case, can I thank you for your evidence this morning. I appreciate your time. And we will, of course, come back to you in due course with progress you've made with your petition.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. The meeting back to order. Our second petition today is petition 1619 on diabetes continuous glucose monitoring sensors. This next petition we'll consider today, petition 1619, is by Stuart Knox. The petition calls for continuous glucose monitoring sensors to be made available on the NHS to all patients with type 1 diabetes. Mr. Knox was invited to provide oral evidence today, but was unable to attend. Members have a copy of the petition and a SPICE briefing. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions.
I sit on the the Diabetes Cross Party Group. And this is discussed a lot. And for me, I think the specifics of this is around during sleep, when there's the potential for, especially in young children, for the depletion of or going to depletion of the sugar levels to a point where right up to loss of life. And there's a lot of evidence around obviously continued monitoring, and there's a lot of real innovation out there, but it seems to be piecemeal in terms of availability on the NHS. And there certainly is in the group, the diabetes group, a call for this, a strong call for this. And it seems to me logical that if this type of innovation is available to some, and certainly there's compelling evidence that we can save lives here, it seems to me that it should be available across the NHS.
So just to clarify, it is available to some on the NHS, but...
Not to all.
But not to all. On yeah. What grounds would they exclude people?
Well, I think it's because it's in... especially the one they mentioned here, the Freestyle Libre one, is very new. It's a new innovation, and it hasn't yet made its way across the whole of the NHS trusts. But it would seem to me that... evidence suggests that this is a treatment that can potentially save lives and should be available.
Okay. Do we have other views?
Well, I'm just looking at the answer to a written question that the Health Secretary gave on the 8th of November. And you can all see it there, where she says work is currently ongoing to develop a national approach for the use of the CGM, and we recognise the speed of development of this technology. I think it might be worthwhile just to, you know, to write to her and ask her how that work is proceeding, and you know, if we could get an approximate kind of timescale on when a decision will be taken on it.
So might I suggest we write to Scottish Government and diabetes organisations, specifically Diabetes UK Scotland, but I don't know if there are others. We could find out if there's others who have a view. The other suggestion that's been made, we spoke before about how we maybe engage with decisions, particularly since we've not had an oral evidence session, but actually maybe find a way of going out and speaking to some of these organisations. I mean, obviously, Brian, you know more about it than others with your interest in the cross-party group, but it would be worthwhile perhaps doing a wee bit of work around speaking to various groups about the issues and challenges, and indeed the way in which technology may be offering some very positive hope for the future.
And the cross-party group is extremely well attended. Mm-hmm. So if you were looking for people to speak to about this, they tend to be all in that room.
Okay. Okay, well, we agree that then. So we're going to contact Scottish Government and diabetes organisations, but we may try and do a wee bit of work around engaging around the issues that have also been flagged up by the petition. Is that agreed? Okay, thank you. We can then move on. The next petition is petition 1621 on sepsis awareness, diagnosis and treatment. This is a new petition by James Robertson calling for the awareness of the early signs of sepsis to be increased among Scottish health professionals and the public. The petition was not open for collecting signatures. Mr Robertson was invited to provide oral evidence to the committee today but was unable to attend. Members have a copy of the petition and a copy of the briefing note. I think it might be worthwhile highlighting that the petition arises out of the petitioner's personal experiences. In the petition, Mr Robertson explains that he's concerned that NHS Scotland is not doing as much to raise awareness of sepsis as has been done in England. To address this, the petition suggests the following three steps: establishing a working group to increase awareness among clinicians and the public of early identification, diagnosis and management of sepsis; working with relevant charities to develop and distribute guidance on sepsis in pre-hospital and hospital settings; and encouraging Scottish Intercollegiate Guidelines Network to review its guidance on sepsis and giving consideration to recent National Institute for Clinical Excellent Guidelines as part of this review. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions. It does seem to me to be highlighting a very important issue too.
Can I register an interest in this? Mr Robertson's a constituent of mine and he asked me to give his apologies for not coming today.
I mean, that's perfectly understandable. Are there suggested actions we might take in this?
Just seems you always do this, but it seems to be that we should be writing to the Scottish Government to see the position on this. I'm quite interested to see where they think the difference is in terms of what's happening south of the border compared to what's happening up here.
Okay.
And what protocols they have, the suggestion is that are the better than the ones we currently have up here.
So we would write to Scottish Government, perhaps the health boards, to see if there's differences in different parts of Scotland.
Yeah.
There's also a suggestion we contact Healthcare Improvement Scotland and the UK Sepsis Trust. I'm not aware what other organisations around us there might be, but they might have an overview of the different bits of the United Kingdom and what has been done in different places.
I agree with all of that. I mean, I think it is an incredibly important subject, and I think we just need to widen the net and get as many views and information as possible. I think it's crucial that this is expanded as widely as it could be.
Okay.
As quickly as possible, because I think sepsis, there is growing issues with it, and we need to move forward rather than the delay on it.
Okay, if that's agreed then. Thank you. If we can then move on to agenda item 2, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of these is petition 1603 on ensuring greater scrutiny, guidance and consultation on armed forces visits to schools in Scotland. When we last considered this petition by Quakers in Scotland and Forces Watch, we agreed to seek further information from a range of organisations, including the Scottish Government, local authorities, the Scottish Youth Parliament, the Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland and the Ministry of Defence. We have received a number of responses and also have a further submission from the petitioners. The petitioners urge the committee to consider the issues raised from a child welfare and rights perspective and offer some suggestions to further action that the committee may wish to consider. I understand that Forces Watch have also prepared a comparison of the responses local authorities gave about the armed forces visits they received with the FOI responses from the MOD for each local authority. They consider that this shows there are discrepancies between the two sets of information, which illustrate their concern that no one has a full picture of what's happening with armed forces visits in state schools. We also have information from Forces Watch about visits to state schools and independent schools. And we've also got a very significant amount of correspondence on this matter. I wonder what members' views are on the responses we've received and suggestions for further action.
Can I just go on record as saying that I think we've got to be careful here, especially when we heard evidence the last time that we've got to make sure we understand that a career in the armed forces is as legitimate a career as anything else. I think, for me, the question seemed to be around specific targeting of a demographic. And I think, as such, I don't think so far the evidence has been particularly clear on this.
Yep.
Can I make an observation? I was in the army for 12 years. My son is currently a serving soldier, and I've actually undertaken, when I was in the army, visits to schools. None of those visits were the intention of recruiting people on the visit. Was to make them aware of the opportunities that the army offered. And the Minister of State for Armed Forces made it clear that there is no specific recruiting that goes on during the visits. If people want to follow up on the visit and look to see what the forces have to offer, that is a completely different process. And I think to suggest that the Army are deliberately going in to target specific people in specific areas is entirely against my experience of when I was doing it in the armed services.
Can I ask if you talked about the opportunities that the armed service provide, would you be talking in realistic terms about what some of the risks of a life in the armed forces were? Because that's one of the contentions of the petitioners, that element of it's not discussed when you go in.
I think that everyone is aware and is currently very aware with the fact that the armed services have been almost on continuous operations for 10 years of the risks involved. And that is made aware to people of where you could be deployed. But there are also skills that the armed services offer, and there are skills and trades that you can get within the army which are recognised as civilian trades. In fact, at a recent visit to Fort George, I was explained all those skills that work in conjunction with UHI and how they're working to develop that. So I think people are inherently aware of the risks that if you go into the armed services, you may be called to serve in places where you do put your life on the line. And I was certainly aware of that when I joined up. And my son was aware of that. And when he consequently went to Afghanistan, it was proved that there were risks. So, but I mean, you know, I think it's pretty disingenuous to suggest that that's hidden or that it's deliberately targeted to recruit people.
Other views?
I inherently disagree with both of my colleagues in the committee. I think that we should look at the response from the Children's Commissioner in Scotland. We're talking about people under the age of 18 here, and I think to say that it's just a career like any other career is disingenuous, because it has risks that other careers don't have. Some of the comments from the Scottish Youth Parliament submission, you know, states that some of the schools and the children found it an unpleasant experience, where the so-called career was being glorified by playing Top Gun music, etc., and comments like "We'll make you a man," etc. I mean, there's just no place for that in our schools, and so I inherently disagree. I just do not think there's a place for the military going to schools any time at all.
The Scottish Youth Parliament submission suggested that of 49 people that had been consulted, 27 had experienced a visit, 17 found it to be positive, 8 found it to be not to be positive, and 2 were unsure. So, you know, I think we're in danger here of as I say, I think from your perspective, and I understand where you're coming from here, I think that we've got to be really careful here. I would be abhorred if I thought that the armed forces were specifically going to target a demographic.
That's another huge well, that's, and I think,
that's
I think
some one of the, at a time.
Sorry.
And that would be a concern. And I would like to know if that was the case. I think but I also think that we have to accept that the army is a very legitimate career, or the armed forces are a very legitimate career for people to pursue, and they have as much right as anybody else to describe a career to in schools as anybody else. And I also think that from what I gather from the evidence, that parents have the ability to they're forewarned and have the ability to take the children out of that particular career opportunity.
Okay, Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. As you say, we've certainly received extensive submissions, including a large number from local authorities, also obviously from the Scottish Government and from the Children's Commissioner. And there are some salient points from Tam Bailey, the Children and Young People's Commissioner. The second last paragraph in the submission says, "My final point relates to the petitioner's suggestion that parents, guardians are consulted as to whether they are happy for their child to take part in armed forces at schools. I would suggest that children in secondary schools would generally be assumed capable of providing informed consent to activities in their own right, as long as they were provided with balanced information before doing so." And then the submission from the Scottish Government also highlights that the local authorities and schools are responsible for considering the arrangements under which any potential employer offers professional advice on career opportunities to pupils. This should be appropriate to their age and maturity and be done in a way which does not seek to exert undue or inappropriate influence. But there's clearly a suggestion that there may be undue or inappropriate influence being exerted, although that's been denied in some quarters. So I think there's an argument to perhaps, I know we have had extensive information and submissions received, but there's maybe that the petitioner's urging us to seek further information from organisations that they've suggested, and I think there's merit in doing that, although it's prolonging the petition, but I think given the seriousness of the issue, I think there's merit in doing that.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I do think clearly there are a range of views in the committee, so see if Solomon's wisdom appears anytime soon in terms of dealing with that. But I think that probably is broadly representative of the views of our communities as well, that first of all, it's a legitimate profession, but are individual particular groups of young people targeted? So I suppose the best case is really try and get the evidence to establish what are the processes. I mean, I was a little disappointed. I understand the pressures on local authorities, but I think they played it with a very just back the thing back without really engaging with what the issues were around confidence for people, that there wasn't an inappropriate access to young people in particular communities. So I feel that Angus's suggestion that we should be looking for more information would be worthwhile, because there's a separate argument whether they should be there at all, but if they are there, are they there on a transparent basis and everybody's confidence that they're not disproportionately targeting particular groups? And that's really, I think, where we need to get the evidence from. Edward?
Convener, can I suggest, I mean, I don't know who of this committee has been on a school visit where the armed forces are there, it, as well as collecting evidence, may I suggest that actually it might be worthwhile seeing what the armed forces do when they go there and how they present it firsthand, so you actually know what's going on? Because I think, with the greatest will of the world, what I'm reading and read in the papers here doesn't reflect my understanding of what goes on the visit.
I mean, I think that's something that people may wish to explore. It is true, I think, what Brian says, that the Scottish Youth Parliament's submission does highlight that, you know, the majority of the young people who were consulted didn't have an issue about the visit. But nevertheless, there is still this question about confidence that particular groups are not being targeted, and that, you know, the way in which the armed forces are represented don't identify the risk factors involved. So I think people may want to take up that offer. But might I suggest we also do look for responses from parents, teachers, schools, children's rights organisations, young people's organisations, veterans bodies. I mean, they may have a particular view as well on how they were recruited themselves, and, you know, it's an awareness of those questions. Another suggestion is the careers bodies such as Skills Development Scotland, who themselves, of course, are engaged in trying to get employers into schools. So what guidance do they apply? What kind of, you know, are companies that offer low skill, low wages, poor conditions, do we make sure they're not targeting particular vulnerable communities with higher levels of unemployment as well? That maybe takes us way beyond the remit of the petition, but if that's agreed, then I think there are a number of issues there that clearly we still want to have some sense that people have confidence in the process and the way in which young people come into contact with the armed forces in school visits. Is that agreed? Okay. If we can then move on to petition 1605 on whistleblowing in the NHS, a safer way to report mismanagement and bullying. This petition is one of three on our agenda by Peter Gregson on behalf of Kids Not Suits. The petition calls for a whistleblowing hotline to be established to replace the existing helpline service. At our previous consideration of this petition, following evidence from the petitioner, the committee agreed to write to Scottish Government, NHS boards, the City of Edinburgh Council, unions, the Salford Royal NHS Foundation Trust, which operates a hotline facility, and Public Concern at Work, the provider of the current National Confidential Alert Line. We've received a number of responses, including from 10 health boards, the Scottish Government, Public Concern at Work. We also have a submission from City of Edinburgh Council, which provides an explanation of how its hotline facility operates. The petitioner has provided a response to these submissions in which he suggests that there's an element of confusion in distinguishing between a helpline and a hotline. There has been quite extensive coverage of this issue since we first considered the petition, including an article by the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland, which subsequently was covered in topical questions at the end of September. So, do members have any views on actions to be taken on this petition?
Convener.
Yep. Angus MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. excuse me. Since this petition was first discussed by this committee, I've actually become more aware of issues in my own health board area, so I'm intrigued by the Chief Executive of NHS Forth Valley's comments in her submission. that in her final paragraph, in which she says to change the existing whistleblowing arrangements and external arrangements are not a solution. Now, I've found the petitioner's response very helpful, and indeed the submission from Rab Wilson, who both reiterate that current measures are inadequate. And from what I'm seeing locally, that would suggest to be it would certainly seem to be the case. So I'd be keen to explore further the establishment of an independent national officer for whistleblowing across health and social care, located in the SPSO office. So with that suggestion that's been put forward, I think, by Unison and others, it would be a basis to invite the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland to perhaps come in and give evidence, and other relevant stakeholders.
Brian?
I agree with that. I think what I'm also interested in is those who would be the potential whistleblowers, and the ones at the coalface. I'm really interested in what their particular view would be in that, and how would we engage with, obviously we can't bring lots and lots of them in. Is there a particular organisation we could speak to who would represent that could speak to this with some degree of authority? Because in the end of the day, it's the ones at the coalface who would be whistleblowing. I think to get a balanced view, to get the Chief Executive in, might not be the most balanced
thing. Well, I wonder whether the unions are very often a kind of a safe place for people to go in order to make complaints. They don't want to make them public themselves. Yeah. Whether they would have any views on that. And they might even have, by definition, a whistleblower is perhaps not the person who wants to come before a committee. And although there are some people here who clearly have waived their own anonymity to talk about the problems they've had in the past. And I do think we're wrestling with this question of helpline, hotline. There's quite a lot there. It looks as if the advice you're getting is to go back to where you've already been and you've not really had the matter resolved. So taking on board Angus' suggestion, I think it would be useful to invite in the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland and other relevant stakeholders, again taking in Brian's point about people who've got the coal face. And there are a number of organisations, including Public Concern at Work and City of Edinburgh Council, have been identified in the petition. We don't particularly want it to be a rerun of past difficulties with whistleblowing that perhaps Mr. Petitioner himself highlighted. I don't think that would be the purpose of it, but it would be to try and get down to what the process and systems that actually do what intended to do, as opposed to a process that people find not particularly useful or helpful. Are there any other suggestions?
I think Angus summed it up for me. I would agree entirely with what he said, and I think the unions should be consulted as well.
Okay, is that agreed then?
I think definitely Unison Scotland should be invited, particularly given when I read the submissions, the worrying fact that there's a significant drop in calls to the helpline. And it would be good to get to the, because there's clearly still issues out there, so it would be good to get to the bottom of why there's been such a drop. Also, the submission from the City of Edinburgh Council, who have implemented a hotline, it seems to be working pretty well. It would be good to get some evidence from them as to, on how exactly they implemented it and how they've made it a success.
Okay. Is that agreed then?
Yes, okay.
Thank you very much for that. We're now moving on to petition 1606, enforcing Scottish councils to collaborate regionally on schools and roads. This is the second of Mr. Gregson's petitions. It calls for local authority budgets to be set to encourage councils to work collaboratively on the provision of education and transport. At our previous consideration, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, COSLA, and the Local Government and Communities Committee. The Scottish Government notes that negotiations on the local government finance settlement are underway, and that, quote, reform opportunities as such as those raised by the petitioner will be discussed within that context. The Local Government Committee referred to the Minister's confirmation that Scottish Government plans to consult on a bill to, quote, decentralise local authority functions, budget and democratic oversight to local communities. Do members have any views on suggested actions on this petition? Gloria?
We close this petition on the basis that, really just from what you said about the Scottish Government's ongoing review, and that this could will form part of it, so I don't see any merit in continuing this particular petition.
Any other views?
Would you close it before the review, the results of the review are out?
Well,
you can bring it back.
I suppose my position would be, first of all, there's a settlement and how people are going to work together under the new community empowerment stuff. There's a big issue around schools' governance and taking them out of local authority controls. These will be issues that will be tested very significantly by the Parliament over the next period. I'm just wondering whether this petition, which basically says they should work together, is actually at, you know, is it simply recognising something that's already happening? It's not challenging the current view. Other views? So Brian's and maybe?
I think it's not going to push anything forward, this petition, from where it's going at the moment.
Angus?
I would agree. I think we should close the petition. I don't think I see any merit in carrying it forward.
Okay. Might I suggest then that, and we are highlighting the fact that these are issues that have been flagged up to the Scottish Government, local government committees aware of it too. We know that there's going to be a debate around this, particularly around questions in governance in schools, but that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that there are current and forthcoming consultation opportunities that will allow the issues raised by the petitioner to be taken forward. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. If we can move on to Petition 1607 on congestion charging in major Scottish cities. Petition 1607 is the third of Mr Gregson's petitions. At our last consideration, we agreed to write Scottish Government, COSLA, the Scottish Local Government Partnership and the Mayor of London. We have received responses from COSLA and the Scottish Government, plus a submission from the petitioner. The Scottish Government maintains its position against road pricing now and in the future, while COSLA suggests that the issue might be discussed when the third report on policies and proposals is published. The petitioner repeats his query as to why current legislation isn't used by local authorities. Do members have any suggestions for action on this petition? Angus?
Well, it's probably a fear factor as far as the local authorities are concerned. I know when I was on Falkirk Council in Edinburgh, the City of Edinburgh Council were planning on introducing a congestion charges. We were all for it in Falkirk, but I wonder if we would have been so in favour of it had it been actually in Falkirk. So it's probably a reluctance on the local authorities to take a bold decision in that regard.
Is there something with the legislation that makes it more difficult for them? Is there something in it that it's not just, well, look what happened to Edinburgh, let's not go there? But is there something else within the legislation that's causing them problems, do you think?
It could well be.
Is that a difficulty?
I mean, you obviously have much more experience than this. Is that a difficult thing to approach?
From my point of view, no. It didn't seem to be. It was just a reluctance to take bold measures.
You didn't want to charge your voters for coming to
it's a radical step.
Yeah, it's...
I think local authorities are looking at other measures. I mean, in Glasgow, car parking is expensive. I think there are issues around, is it Edinburgh that's reduced its speed limit to 20 miles an hour? In the city centres, people are taking different measures, perhaps address some of the same problems.
The introduction of more parking rides and things like that could help, but...
Would it be worth just checking? Is there some block in the current legislation by local authorities? I suppose we could just address that specific question to COSLA. I don't know if they answered it. The other option is to defer further consideration of the petition until it becomes clear whether relevant issues will be included within the RPP3.
I think we could do both, convener, seek clarification and defer, because clearly there may be measures in RPP3 that... that will assist councils, local authorities to take action.
Okay, is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. If we can then move on to petition 1608 on wholly owned national private pharmaceuticals. Petition 1608 is a continued petition lodged by Martin Keatings and calling for the establishment and ownership of a medical manufacturing organisation in Scotland to provide manufacturing of drugs out of patent and to develop and research new drugs in line with the needs of the Scottish population. At our previous consideration, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Association of the British Pharmaceutical Industry and the British Generics Manufacturers Association. The ABPI said it did not have any concern in principle to what the petitioner was suggesting, but that it was ultimately for the Scottish Government to assess the benefits and costs for such an enterprise. We have the Scottish Government's response. It doesn't consider the proposal to be feasible or sustainable. It considers the existing arrangements and policies work well, but says that it will consider any future policy changes following the Montgomery Review. And I wonder what member suggestions are on how we proceed with this petition.
To the petition, I think that the Scottish Government's views have been set. It's quite clear in the bullet points the arguments for not doing it. And I think the Montgomery Review, you know, should answer some of these. But I don't see any merit in keeping this petition going. I think that the petition's been answered sufficiently by the Scottish Government response.
Anyone else?
I have to agree. I think the, you know, the whole principle of the petition kind of flies in the face of what, you know, what's currently happening. There's nothing to stop, you know, a pharmaceutical company setting up in Scotland as it is, apart from the fact that it would cost a fortune to do that. And I think, as you say, we're already really well served. I can't see how this petition can go anywhere.
I mean, presumably it may be an issue in the future for individual political parties who are seeking election to put that in a manifesto, something that they would have done a bit of work on and identified. And we know that there will be findings from the Montgomery Review which may inform future decisions, but we agreed that at, for the time being that we agree to close the petition.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. If we can then move on to petition 1609 on NHS Scotland treatments. The next petition is petition 1609 on NHS Scotland treatments by Robert Marks. The petition calls on the NHS to refuse treatments to patients with what are considered to be self-inflicted illnesses and conditions and for the financial savings to be allocated to other areas of NHS Scotland. At our last consideration of this petition, we agreed to write to the Scottish Government seeking its views on the action called for by the petition and information on what measures the Scottish Government is taking to promote preventative care and early intervention. A response has been received, and the Scottish Government notes that current health policy seeks to engage citizens positively in improving their health rather than sanction them for the choices they make. It also outlined a number of its preventative and early intervention healthcare initiatives and its views on the most cost-effective and ethical way to treat illnesses. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions on next stages.
I think ethically, You cannot judge somebody on their personal decisions and when they become ill or maybe not taking treatments that they're recommended to them, and I don't think our society would ever agree to non-treatment of an illness. I cannot see where this petition can go, and I personally would like to close the petition.
I would agree with Brian. I think on grounds of compassion that it's not something that anyone would be in a position to sign up to. So I think you should close the petition.
Okay, any other views?
I agree with both my colleagues here.
Yeah. Okay, in that case, we're agreeing to close the petition under Standing Order Rules 15.7 on the basis that current healthcare policy is aimed at prevention and early intervention and that the Scottish Government has set out its view on the most cost-effective and ethical way to treat illnesses. And that with the emphasis on preventative help, we would hope that way you would address the problems that perhaps have motivated the petition. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. And finally, petition 1610 on upgrade of the A75. The final petition on the agenda today is petition 1610 by Matt Halliday, calling on an upgrade to the A75. members of a submission from the Scottish Government providing an update following the Transport Summit held in Dumfries on the 22nd of August 2016. Members are advised that the Minister for Transport in the Islands has announced an update to the Strategic Transport Projects Review and a review of the National Transport Strategy. Options for dualling the A75 will be considered as part of these reviews. The Scottish Government could not provide a timetable for this process, but said it would keep the committee informed. Members also have a submission from the petitioner, who has expressed concern at the uncertain timeframe for making a decision on this issue. Mr Halliday is concerned that the local region is negatively affected by the current condition of the A75, and the impact may worsen if action is not taken to upgrade the road soon. Do members have any comments or suggestions?
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned the last time I was at the summit that the Transport Minister chaired, and I think some of the actions that he took away from that was to consider a range of inputs from the floor. I think the fact that we mentioned before this is a Euro route. I think that we mentioned before that there's a high volume of articulated lorries passing through some small villages, and not all of these villages have speed cameras and the like. I think there's also the impact or potential impact on Stranraer as a port if this part of the Euro route is not dualled, given that there's evidence that another couple of ports south of the border have had significant investment in development, and that there is this perceived threat to Stranraer. I would personally like to move this on quite swiftly, and I would like to suggest that we request the Transport Minister to come in and give us an update. Another possibility, of course, is to bring in the MSPs that represent that specific area, because they have more information than I do on this. But I think it's something that it needs to be brought to the fore and pushed on.
Mm-hmm. Well, of course, any MSP would be free to come to the Petitions Committee, and we have had experience of that with other petitions, so that would be an invitation that people would be aware of. The question is really, the question is about not having an absolute timetable. So would it be worthwhile writing to the Minister to say, given the uncertain concern, we would expect a timetable? And that if that's not forthcoming, or if it continues to be, we're not very sure, it is something we could consider further in the new year. Because if they're having a review, I don't know how long reviews normally take, but I'm sure people locally would want to know it was an active review as opposed to long grass.
I think I'm if I remember correctly, and the Minister suggested that there would be a reply to the conference by the turn of the year, by the end of the year, which is why I'm suggesting that we ask the Minister to come here and perhaps update us on where they are.
Okay. I would be happy to defer it. I mean, we're until the new year, to the very start of the new year, and then ask for a further update. I'm not sure what merit there would be in bringing the Minister here before the end of the year.
Well, we wouldn't be able to do that realistically. I suggest that what we do is we write to the Minister saying, mm-hmm. in general terms from the committee, we would want some certainty around timescale. They must have one, even if they've not made it public. They must. Their own officials must be working to an expectation of when they should be reporting.
Okay.
And if they can share that information with us, good and well. If they continue to say they don't have a timescale, then I think at that point we can make a decision, perhaps, when we get that response, mm-hmm. whether we would have the Minister in.
I agree. Yeah.
Is that agreed?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think that is... We have concluded all of the items in the agenda, and can I thank you all for your attendance. Close the meeting.